Well, good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. The first item on the agenda is a decision by the committee to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed on that?
Yes.
Thank you. Now, I have apologies from Dean Lockhart and Gordon MacDonald, committee members. I would ask everyone to turn electrical devices to silent or any other device off that might interfere with the work of the committee. We come then to our panel of witnesses for our first panel this morning. And just to indicate, if you wish to come in on a question or discussion, please just indicate by raising your hand. The sound desk will deal with the microphone, so you don't need to press any buttons or anything. And may I welcome then, first of all, Christine McKenzie, who is from Public Affairs, or is the Public Affairs Manager for SSE Scotland. Jenny Hogan, who's the Director of Policy for Scottish Renewables. Lindsay McQuaid, the Policy and Innovation Director from Scottish Power Renewables. And Stuart Hazeldean, who's Professor of Carbon Capture and Storage at the University of Edinburgh. So first of all, thank you very much to all of our guests for coming in this morning. I'd like to start with just a general question before we come to specific questions from the different committee members. And of course, you'll be aware that we are looking at the government's climate change plan and energy strategy. And I just wonder if each of you would like to perhaps comment, criticise or question which key points there are for you looking at that. Perhaps start with Christine McKenzie.
Yeah, hi. One thing, I suppose, overarching in general, we're very positive about both documents and welcome the ambition in both documents. But something that I think needs to be explored further is a route to market for some of the more ambitious technologies. So that would include particularly areas like CCS, pumped storage, and even the future upwards trajectory for onshore wind for reasons that most people are aware. So I think generally we're very, very positive about both documents, but just more detail on a route to market, and I realise they're consultations, so we'll be putting in full responses to both of them.
Thank you. Jenny Hogan.
Good morning. Yes, I would echo what Christine said. We very much welcome the high level of ambition in both the draft energy strategy and the draft climate change plan. In particular, the target to deliver 50% of energy demand from renewables by 2030, and also taking a whole system view. Both of these were proposals that Scottish Renewables put forward, so that's very welcome. We also recognise that a substantial part of the target is going to be reliant on UK government policy, similar to what Christine alluded to there in terms of route to market in particular, also to some extent EU policy. However, I think it is important that the Scottish Government has set this high level of ambition and vision for Scotland. And of course, it can use its devolved powers as far as possible while working closely with the UK government to maximise the use of reserve powers there. I think also just to highlight that both documents are quite high level strategies with not a huge amount of detail on delivery. There's a lot in there, although quite a lot of it is a restatement of existing policy. So we'd very much welcome more detail and recognise that much of that detail is still to come through the consultation processes. And also some more detail on the relative benefits of the policies that have been put forward and furthering impact assessment, which I think would also be welcome.
Thank you. Lindsay McQuaid.
Morning. Like the others have said, we also welcome the publication of the climate change plan and the accompanying energy strategy. I think we're particularly pleased to see that the Times model has been used to effect in the publication of the CCP, and that gives a clear steer in terms of policy direction and desired policy outcome, which is an excellent context in which to set this ambition in. The 66% target for reduction in emissions is clearly something that we are passionate in supporting, and it aligns with a number of our corporate objectives. We're part of the Iberdrola group, who globally have targeted 50% reduction in emissions by 2030 and to be a carbon neutral power generator by 2050. So the ambition that Scottish Government has set out clearly chimes in with our strategic objectives as well as an organisation. We've obviously spent some time looking over the CCP and the energy strategy, and we'll be taking further time to consider the questions raised therein. We would note that they are ambitious and helpful that they have that shape that we can work towards, and look forward to responding to the consultation.
Thank you very much. And Stuart Hazeldine.
As has already been said, this is a terrific place to be working because it's a really good ambition. It's the right ambition. I think it's founded on climate science evidence and direction of travel and the right trajectory to arrive at 2050, in fact. So I see this as a part of a pathway to 2050, and 2032 is a stepping stone on the way to that, and has to be aligned with the direction of travel to 2050, which both these documents do very well. Again, we're particularly pleased to see the integration with an all-energy system model, because that makes different parts of the energy user and the all-energy spectrum take responsibility for all their own actions, and it's impossible for people to blame each other for lack of delivery. It's an integrated portfolio. Again, a lot of this on a route to actually how you deliver this is uncertain, unclear at the moment. So a lot of this may depend on UK policy, particularly with bigger items, but in Scotland we've been really very successful in finding niches and ways through that, and we have to do that. But I think it will get a lot more difficult, because in some ways we've had great success so far in decarbonising and providing renewable electricity by closing down a lot of the older high carbon equipment that we have and have had previously, and actually to move forward and go less and less carbon and more sustainable will require a lot more innovation and invention than I think we've been accustomed to in the past. And again, if I'm representing part of the university sector on this group of four rather than the commercial delivery sector, then we have to work together with that.
Thank you very much. We'll come then to a question from Gillian Martin.
This is a question for people representing the electricity sector. I'd like you, if you take me through your progress to date in cutting the emissions in line with the previous climate change plan, and how you've achieved that so far. Have you achieved that so far?
So far in Scotland, we've displaced about 13 million tonnes of carbon dioxide through renewable energy and renewable electricity in particular. That's been a huge amount of success so far, and there's still a huge amount of development of projects in the pipeline. And we have about 8 gigawatts of installed renewable electricity capacity in Scotland at the moment. And I think, just referring to the strategy, there's a range of between 11 and 17 gigawatts additional capacity planned in the strategy up to 2030. We had proposed for a doubling of renewable electricity capacity, so obviously going from 8 to around about 16 gigawatts. So we would really be pushing towards the high end of that range. And that capacity is very much in the pipeline, so that development can happen as long as there are various policies that can allow it. Coming back to the point about route to market, again, very much relying on UK government to allow all technologies, both established technologies and less established technologies, to be able to compete for long-term contracts for power. But also the Scottish Government has a lot within its power that it can do to help the industry to reduce costs through planning, business rates, for example, and other forms of regulation.
Okay. And the targets that have been set in this climate change plan, are they achievable?
They are. I'll come back in. So we proposed that target as well, the 50% target. Very much we believe it is achievable, although it is very ambitious, and I think that the strategy does recognise that. It does, as I mentioned earlier, rely a lot on UK government policies and to some extent EU policies, so I think we have to be realistic about that and accept that this is not all within the Scottish Government's gift. However, if Scottish Government uses its powers as far as possible and works closely with UK government, and of course seeing what comes through on in terms of EU policies and how they're transposed into the UK, yes, I think it can be achievable, yeah.
Because that's kind of the elephant in the room, really. we are coming out of the EU, so there are going to be certain powers, and it's going to be a case of to which government they go. Do you think that's something that you would like to lobby on in terms of which powers from the EU which would affect your meeting your targets where they come?
At this stage, we don't have clear policies across our membership on and specifically what policies we would want to come across. The main things for us is that we're able to compete similar to the way we can now in terms of trading across European countries and beyond. Currently, of course, we would have access to the integrated energy market, and we very much look forward to seeing how those kinds of abilities that we have now can continue. But obviously, there are lots of different potential options of how that might happen under different situations. So things like continued access to skilled staff is something that's important to the industry as well. But in terms of what model might come forth, I think that's still all to be discussed.
Okay. I think Gil Patterson wanted to come in with a supplementary, and Stuart Hazeldine, I think, wanted also to come in. So I'll let Gil ask his question and then.
Yes, you don't mind. Thanks, Chairman. It's in relation to targets, and I wonder if the fact that the subsidies have been cut, will that impact on the government, the Scottish government's targets? And is there a likelihood that the private sector will invest to replace that subsidy?
I think Stuart Hazeldine wanted to come in, and then we'll come to Lindsay McQuaid. Okay.
So that's a hard question to answer. But what I wanted to comment on was picking up on the change in European membership. I think the European Emissions Trading Scheme has been an overarching umbrella to guide a pathway to emissions reduction for a lot of what the UK has done in electricity generation and in industry emissions. And that then, by leaving Europe, that overarching system will obviously disappear as an obligation, and it's a question of whether we're going to have a shadow system in the UK which will dictate a trajectory and enforce an overall carbon price across the economy, or are we going to abandon that and take responsibility either sectorally or as different parts of the UK to deliver our trajectory on that. And that is, to me, is a really major change, because in the European trading system, it was very likely that the carbon price will try to be pushed up from its present €5 a tonne of carbon dioxide up towards 20 or even 40 euros a tonne of carbon dioxide. And knowing whether we're going to go along a similar pathway or a parallel pathway will dictate the economics of the delivery of all of this.
Thank you. Lindsay McQuaid.
Thank you. To answer Jill's questions first, I think Scottish Power Renewables have made a significant contribution to decarbonisation in Scotland. We have an established portfolio of around 1,400 megawatts operating in Scotland just now, and we're currently constructing around £1 billion worth of onshore wind assets. Turning to Gil's point on subsidy, that was done under the previous regime, the renewables obligation, which very successfully has established an onshore wind sector in Scotland. Acknowledging that scheme was due to end in 2017, and there have been changes. However, there has been a grace period provision allowed to ease the impact on investor confidence. That's been relatively well managed, and we've continued to have confidence to invest in our pipeline going forward. Looking ahead to a route to market and encouraging a level playing field between technologies as well, we would like to see onshore wind continuing to have a role. I'm pleased to note that in the documents that have been published, there is clearly a future requirement for onshore wind to continue to contribute, and that's very helpful as well. In terms of cost reduction and competition, I think the implementation of a framework like the CFD, the Contract for Difference mechanism that has been that's gone through one round, that's very successfully driving down the costs that we see coming in from renewables, and that's reducing the burden onto consumers. Having access to a competition like that and an auction is a helpful way of continuing to give investors confidence that there's a mechanism that they can invest against to bring forward further capacity, whilst protecting the consumer from this change that we need to enable through to achieve decarbonisation targets.
So, so you think that the public sector is able to pick the ball up and run that the costs itself are of a nature that itself, you know, it's self-financing and not needing the subsidy. Is that what you're saying?
I think a framework is required to sustain that investment.
Okay.
I mean, there's no form of new investment and new generation happening just now because the wholesale price continues to be volatile, and it's a very difficult forecast. Nobody has the perfect crystal ball that tells us what the prices are going to be against these long-term assets that we're investing in. Particularly so for renewables, where they are an upfront capitally intensive investment. We can't hedge against how and when the wind will blow. We can't hedge against input fuel, if you like. And that creates a need for us to have some certainty in the type of revenue that we need to facilitate that investment and ensure that we can efficiently attract capital so that we're not pricing risk unnecessarily into that investment. There's possibly a role around corporate PPAs. I'm not sure if that's where you were going, but the GOEC that has been proposed, the government energy company that was proposed within the documents as well, it's an interesting concept. I'd be pleased to understand more about that and have further discussions with it, with officials on that as well, and we'll be answering that in the consultation. But I think it's important to note that that's the corporate PPA market is effectively a niche market, and it wouldn't necessarily sustain the amount of capacity that Jenny mentioned, between 11 and 17 gigawatts, that we see as being required to achieve our decarbonisation targets. So whilst those routes, those mechanisms can operate in parallel, but it requires a consumer at the end to be there willing to pay a premium for green energy to give that stability. There's a need to fund that investment. And over the long term, there is a move back to seeing, through the CFD mechanism as well, seeing money over and above the wholesale energy price being returned to consumers. So it's really just that certainty and risk mitigation tool that we're looking for to sustain the investment just now in the pipeline.
Thank you. And I think Richard Lind wanted to come in with a small supplementary. Christine McKenzie to come in with an answer, as well as Stuart Hazeldine. So Richard's question, and then we'll come to Christine McKenzie and then Stuart.
Thanks, Colin. My question particularly is, I think, to Lindsay McQuaid and to Christine McKenzie, which is to pick up on the point about the exceptional levels of investment that have been in renewables over the last decade and a half. But perhaps you could tell us a little bit more about the extent to which Scotland's manufacturing base, Scottish jobs have been created, Scottish steelmaking has benefited from that level of investment. And if you can't tell me this morning, even perhaps if you could supply that information to us. I mean, I reflect especially on the Beatrice offshore project, where I know the fabrication work is being conducted in part in Scotland, but two-thirds of it is being constructed in Denmark and Holland.
Yeah, that's fine. Just to come back on a few of the points. I think just on the onshore subsidy point, I think it's disappointing there's currently not a route to market, but we're still enthusiastic that might come forward in a framework. To echo what Lindsay said, I think that there's a job to be done there, looking for a framework that might potentially open the route to more onshore wind. We've not given up on it, because after all, onshore wind continues to be the cheapest low carbon generation form of energy you can build, and it can also support local supply chains in a way that other renewable sources perhaps can't so well. But to come back to what Gillian's point as well, I think emissions reductions in the power sector have been driven by a combination of huge investment in renewables by UK-wide policies, but also the reduction in coal. And when it comes to Brexit, from SSE's perspective, the key thing that we want to maintain is the EMR principles. So things like the CFD auction, things like the capacity market and carbon price floor, I think if those elements can remain intact, but also we want to keep trading with the EEA on energy and the EC on energy. And I think given keeping energy supplies stable is in everyone's interests, then that we're hopeful that that can be achieved. I was also going to pick up what Lindsay said on PPAs. We've got optimism around the Scottish Government's proposals on PPAs, but I think a lot more needs to be done in terms of exploring how they would actually work and if they would provide a solution. I think I was also going to pick up on Beatrice. So Beatrice is £2.6 billion of investment. Beatrice is obviously offshore wind, so it's slightly different because there's still a mechanism in place to support that in terms of government support. that we use as much, especially with SSE, we use as much Indigenous supply as we possibly can. We've just had great contracts awarded with BIFAB and Babcock and Rosyth, and we've got Wick Harbour being renovated, 90 jobs created up there already. So we do as much as we can, but I'll come back to you on the exact detail of what we're sourcing from abroad and what we're sourcing within the UK supply chain.
Okay, I want to pick up that it sounds to me as a lot of this discussion has just been around electricity delivery again, and it's very clear from both the energy strategy and the climate strategy that 50% of our energy demand at least is for heat, and we've got another challenge in decarbonising transport, and we also have to protect our industry from emissions charges. And I haven't heard any conversation about how to do all those yet. And a lot of that is, again, within the gift. Some of those price support mechanisms, like a renewable heat incentive, are in the remit of UK government. There's a lot of wishful thinking about how we can support our industries to avoid carbon leakage or avoid closure or avoid migration to other parts of the world. But I think we should perhaps think about taking an even more positive view about how in Scotland are we going to be very assertive about this and to create low carbon industrial zones, which can act not to preserve the past, but to actually attract the future in, attract future low carbon industrial manufacture and future low carbon industrial exports from Scotland. And powering those or supplying heat and power to those is a slightly different question to what I think we've just been talking about, but a very big, very, very big question indeed.
Lindsay McQuaid.
Just to come back to your point on supply chain, I think there's an interesting position within Scotland as well. I think Jenny mentioned earlier on that we've just over 8.3 gigawatt of installed capacity, and I believe there's another couple of gigawatt under construction as we speak. So that's a sizable proportion of generation in Scotland. There's also 43,500 people employed in the low carbon and renewable sector in Scotland. So again, it's a significant employer, a skilled workforce, offers good careers, good and interesting careers to support that sector as well. With regard to the installed capacity that we have, whilst there's possibly limited opportunity to bring a wholesale manufacturer of turbines, for example, in, there is an opportunity in terms of the components. We've seen the likes of CES Wind invest in Campbellton and Macrahanish, and they continue to be used locally as well. There's also a huge opportunity in terms of the consumables of those sites, and remanufacturing is something that we've been speaking with enterprise agencies about in terms of extending the longevity and the life extension prospects of that installed capacity that we have, so that we can continue to get good productive clean energy from those assets that we've already invested in. That could be things like blades, gearboxes, the more consumable parts of the turbine. So classically, and again, it's picked up in the documents that have been published, a planning consent was perhaps issued for 25 years. 25 years was the best estimate at the point of consent as to how long we would see these assets running for. I think having gone through the experience of operating those assets for a prolonged period, we understand there's actually more that they can do. And if we selectively invest in key components, we can extend the life and extend the production. And it would be interesting to work on supply chain strategies to try and cultivate what we can develop in Scotland to support those plant.
Okay. I'd like to come now to John Mason for further questions.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, to follow up something you said, Professor Hazeldine, about the relative amount we're expecting reduced emissions from electricity in comparison to other areas like, say, service or residential. I mean, are we being unrealistic? Are we expecting too much of a reduction from electricity in comparison to some of these other sectors?
I think we've done phenomenally well on reducing the carbon intensity of our electricity. It's now down to something like 200 grams per kilowatt hour or something like this, so it's really, really low. We can progress further with that with the renewable electricity developments we've talked about. I'm certain we can deliver that. It may cost more than you think if Scotland has to bear the full cost of doing that, and because at the moment the cost of all this is a lot of the cost is smeared out amongst the whole of the UK, and I don't think we fully account for that. What we also have to realise is that even with all this renewable capacity, renewable delivery still has the issue of being intermittent. It's variable through time. And there are clearly periods of the year which can be hours, days, or even weeks at a time when the delivery of electricity from wind power is nothing like the demand. So it's unclear to me the moment that Scotland can go it alone on that basis, because we need interconnectors to other countries, England, maybe other countries in Europe, which will allow us to import electricity as and when necessary, because we do that now with the closure of our thermal generating plant. We're a lot more, there's a lot more arbitrage between Scotland and England than there used to be. And we need to develop a lot more thinking about how we're going to store delivery of electricity. And then if we go on to think about the heat delivery to houses and to businesses and to industry, if you look at the graphs in the energy strategy, for example, which are usually around page 36 or page 20, then the demand for heat varies by a factor of 6 through the year, and the heat demand, the heat energy supply, is something like 4 or 5 times the electricity supply. So how to decarbonize your heat is going to be a much more significant question. So you've got a choice of, at the moment it looked like a choice of electrifying everything, so you deliver your heat through electricity, which will be at the moment a very expensive way of doing that, or do you deliver your heat through other energy vectors, such as hydrogen is discussed in these documents, which to me seems a very plausible method. But then we have to think about how we supply that hydrogen at a feasible cost. And so the cheapest way of providing,
I think some of my colleagues have got questions,
is fossil fuel conversion. So delivering all this electricity seems very doable. Delivering the other 3/4, I think we're still in the realm of knowing which direction we want to travel in, and we have to do some inventing and innovating on the way. And it's premature to decide exactly how we're going to do that delivery. So renewing these types of documents every few years and reviewing where we've got to is very sensible. So we can't make final decisions yet.
Right, so you've kind of laid out just now the challenges that each of the sectors face.
Yeah.
So are you happy that we go ahead with this, you know, expecting quite a lot from electricity at this stage and then see what happens in a few years' time? Or do you feel at the moment we should be maybe reducing our expectations of electricity and increasing our expectations in other sectors?
I think we should be... If I repackage your question slightly, I think we should continue with developing renewables at appropriate cost, as has been outlined by the 3 other witnesses, but we also need to start very seriously working on how we're going to deliver the reductions in emissions on transport and industry and on heat, because those are much bigger challenges than we've faced so far. So we continue steering as we are on electricity and expect to see 100% renewable electricity as the default position, but to solve the other challenges needs a lot of serious work, and we need to engage with other actors with that.
Okay, thanks very much. If I could move on, I mean, the whole question of how much installed renewable capacity there is, and Ms. Hogan, you referred to, I think, presently 8 gigawatts, is that correct? And we've got this quite wide range, it seems to me, of 11 to 17 by 2030. And if I'm correct, the Committee on Climate Change had a different... By 2020, they were talking about a different figure somewhere in between. I mean, there seem to be a lot of figures floating around, and it seems to be a very wide range, 11 to 17. I mean, is that just the way it is? Do we need to pin it down a bit more? Or can you explain that to me?
Sure. So, yeah, I think that's a very important point to highlight, and I was going to come back to that point anyway. So, yes, it is quite a wide range. As I said earlier, we'd be very keen to focus on the higher end of that range. We believe that we do need to double existing capacity up to 2030, so that would be towards the 16, 17 gigawatt range in order to do that. I'd say that they're actually quite aligned with the Committee on Climate Change, as well as other analysis, such as WWF's recent analysis. They're all calling for around about a doubling of capacity in 2030 or by 2030. So I'd say they're more or less in the same ballpark. In terms of kind of relating that to the previous question as well, there is obviously CCS clearly has quite a big part of this strategy. It's seen as critical, I think, to meeting the targets. And we don't have a view on CCS or other non-renewable technologies. But what I would say is that it would seem prudent to at least aim for the higher end of renewable electricity generation, in case more nascent technologies take longer to develop, or if there's any issues with meeting the expectations in the strategy, given that they're at an earlier stage, and just given the fact that so many of the renewable technologies are mature already and are in the pipeline and more or less ready to go. Maybe just touching on the heat as well. I mean, I think the strategy is very, very ambitious on heat, which is great as well. I would agree with what Stuart says, that this is absolutely critical as well. And it's really been the Cinderella of renewable energy policies and more widely low carbon energy policies. The targets for 94% of non-domestic buildings and 80% for domestic buildings to move on to low carbon heat technologies in 2032 is very welcome, but very stretching. There's not a huge amount of detail yet in the strategies to say exactly how those targets will be met, and there does seem to be quite a lot of backloading, so not much seems to be happening up to 2025, and then suddenly there's quite a big drop. So that's something that we would really question. Is there not more that we can do on renewable heat now? There are technologies available in both renewable and low carbon heat, particularly looking at off-gas grid areas and district heating in urban areas. So we really urge to move as quickly as possible on the regulation and other policy measures on heat.
Okay, thanks. I mean, I think some of my colleagues will delve into that a bit more deeply, but that's fine. Thanks.
Okay. Ash Denham.
Good morning. So there's been quite a bit of emphasis put on the CCS as part of the strategies, and the Scottish Government have said that they would like to see the UK government strategy aligned with Scottish energy priorities, but there doesn't seem to be any mention of it at all in the recent industrial strategy consultation that the UK government put out. So it seems that might not be the case going forward. And if we look at, do you pronounce it, is it BECCS or do you call it BECCS by any chance? You do, okay. So Biofuel Watch were talking about BECCS and they said it's overhyped. They said that massive scale up is unproven. They said it'd be highly complex. So I'm wondering if the panel could give a view on whether they think what the feasibility is of CCS with these other technologies to deliver negative emissions going forward.
I can start from a business point of view. We obviously had Peterhead and the potential with Shell's CCS project, but I think it's a year past the autumn statements of 2015. We obviously had the announcement that would no longer be the case. So really since then, from an SSE perspective, CCS has not been something that we've been expecting any realistic route to market for at any time. So from any government, UK or Scottish or otherwise. So I suppose that the SSE works on the basis of a mix of energy sources. We're obviously the largest renewables generator in UK and Ireland, but we do have a range of sources across the GB and Ireland network. So CCS, in terms of the technology behind it and the mechanics of it, I suppose we wouldn't have a strong view that it should be pushed or otherwise, but if there was another opportunity that came up in a business context that might make it feasible, we would probably look at that, but at the moment we've not seen anything that suggests that might happen anytime soon.
Lindsay McQuaid.
Just to echo what Christine said, as the committee is probably aware, we undertook the largest study ever of a coal station in terms of the feed study that we undertook at Longannet, with a view to establishing a 300 megawatt CCS project. That study was completed and the submission made to the UK government. And unfortunately, the price point was too high. At 1.5 billion for the 300 megawatt project, the feeling was it was just too expensive against the £1 billion cap that they'd set. And I think when we look at the cost of other technologies in there, and particularly the impact as it then comes back to the consumer, we have to be very mindful of what we're actually asking the consumer to support through their energy bill. So having a competitive allocation for the most cost-effective technologies to come in and decarbonise the network is something that we should be looking at. CCS could play a role going forward, but I think right now the price point is just a bit too high for us. But that said, going forward in the future, if there was the opportunity to see that change, certainly something we would be looking at from a business perspective.
Professor Hazeldine.
On CCS then, I think two main points straight away is that it's important to realise that we've been, during the past 10 years, dragged into a conversation about CCS being applied onto electricity generation, and that's because of the obsession from the UK government about fitting carbon capture and storage to decarbonise coal-fueled electricity and coal-generated electricity. Clearly, competing with low-cost established electricity has been really difficult, and it's very difficult to compete, to innovate anything big into that space where there are established producers of electricity which are either running off power plant which has already been paid for and therefore has very low marginal cost, or are running renewables which also have their own price subsidy and are therefore difficult to compete against. So it's no surprise that CCS has difficulty on power plant. Second point is that the way the competitions were set up by the UK government meant that a huge amount of business risk and business problems were left with the developer, and that was priced in to those very high prices which we've just heard about. And I contrast that with other parts of the world where the low carbon electricity is being delivered for around about £100 a megawatt hour, so about half or two-thirds of what we were quoted for the UK. And clearly that is something to do with not with the technology but with the way the UK chose to develop that. I want to then move on to say that CCS isn't a single gadget, it's a way of reducing carbon emissions in the energy system. And so if we think about how we're going to travel down this decarbonisation route for effective low-cost decarbonisation, it's very instructive that the TIMES model chooses to use carbon capture and storage, because the TIMES model is about optimising low-cost delivery of decarbonisation across the whole energy system. It's not just choosing CCS on electricity, it can choose to do CCS on heat, on transport, on industry, and I think CCS applies to all of those areas, and we should get out of the conversation about thinking about one direction for carbon capture and storage. So if we think about how we're going to decarbonise our industry emissions from, let's say, the east of Scotland Grangemouth complex, then CCS is the key way of doing that, and we need to address that for the future. If we think about how we're going to supply low carbon heating, if we're going to supply that through the means of hydrogen, we have to generate the hydrogen, and CCS is a key part of that delivery. If we think about how we're going to supply low-carbon transport, we could do that through electric vehicles, but there are perfectly valid technologies emerging for hydrogen fuel cell vehicles, which could provide much more consumer-facing and consumer-friendly vehicles. And the hydrogen, again, can be supplied through the medium of CCS. And the other way of thinking about, fourth point is that we've thought about this as very, very big projects in the UK, driven by the UK government. And there's carbon capture, CO2 separation from industrial wastes going on in Edinburgh right now. This can happen at small scale, at medium scale, and at large scale, not just at immense power plant scale. And part of the proposals we've put forward from University of Edinburgh and Scottish Carbon Capture and Storage, which I can send to the committee later, is that we should think about multiple tracks on this. We don't have control over very large investment in power plant, that's a UK control, but we do in Scotland have the ability to develop carbon capture, transport and storage off these small and medium-sized enterprises, such as combined heat and power plants which use biomass, such as brewing and distilling, such as local small power units, such as paper making, such as glass making. All of these are Scottish industries and Scottish wealth creation which are going to need decarbonising in the future, and all of which are very in need of decarbonising their emissions before they get closed down by the European Emissions Trading Scheme or whatever the replacement will be. And so we have to start now, and we can start now, and develop all of those types of low-carbon application. So this is not just about electricity, it's about looking at the decarbonising the whole of our energy economy.
Okay, so if I'm understanding you correctly, we had questions about the idea of whether the CCS should be Plan A, but it's, you seem to be saying it is certainly part of the initial plan, but it would need to be with other things as well, but we shouldn't be discounting it at this stage. Is that a fair summary?
I'm saying that that capturing carbon dioxide emissions is absolutely part of Plan A, but Plan A is not just about electricity. Mm. Plan A is about, as is correctly pointed out in the Times model, Plan A is across the whole of the energy use in Scotland. And so in the climate strategy, it's portrayed that we should go to negative emissions from 2027 onwards, and that should continue. Now, negative emissions is actually part of the trajectory towards 2050, because from the Paris 2015 United Nations Agreement, we're expecting to have a net zero economy around 2050. And as part of our emissions portfolio right now, we claim about minus 10 million tonnes a year from forestry use. That at the moment is accounted for by growing the trees. If we want to use the trees, and if we, let's say, want to convert those trees by burning them as biomass, part of your question earlier on, then just burning those and putting the carbon back into the atmosphere is only part of the value. The true value is in taking the carbon out of the atmosphere into trees, creating a rural economy by reforesting large areas of Scotland, mm-hmm. using those trees in construction and also in fuel, but taking the carbon dioxide emissions and putting that underground. And you're quite right that BECCS biomass carbon capture and storage does not exist on a commercial scale. There are isolated examples around the world where carbon capture is happening on emissions which are derived from biomass by making alcohol, for example. That's very straightforward to capture the carbon dioxide from those sort of emissions. So we could do that in Scotland on our distilling and our brewing industries, for example. Mm-hmm. That's carbon dioxide emissions going into atmosphere as pure carbon dioxide now, which we could and should be thinking about capturing now. There's no need to wait for this. We can extend that if we want to do combined heat and power schemes using biomass, then that's all very fine, but that would still emit carbon into the atmosphere. And it doesn't matter if that's carbon from biomass or carbon from fossil fuel, that's still carbon. So if we're going to do combined heat and power schemes, we need to work out how we're going to catch the carbon from the fuel source in those schemes, whether that's natural gas, whether that's or biomass. How are we going to do that? And we haven't thought that through yet. So all that needs, what I'm saying, we need to start off on the research push for doing that and the development push in conjunction with power and heat vendors. That can be done. I think there are clear examples, and I think even Biofuel Watch will admit there are examples where gasification of biomass, for example, which is a much more efficient way of using biomass, the gasification step is difficult, but is claimed to have worked in a few instances around the world where there's been close cooperation between research and development and an equipment developer. And that's now in Scotland we're facing this innovation frontier, because we're one of the first countries in the world to get as far as we've got. So we're now facing the cutting edge challenge of what to do next and how to invent and how to develop the new technologies which we will need to get down our low carbon trajectory, and the low carbon technologies which we can then design and sell on to other countries by doing that. So this is an opportunity, not a burden, an opportunity to develop something new. And it's, so again, I say this is not just about renewable electricity, this is about decarbonising the whole economy. And it's clear from all energy models, not just the one we've run Times on Scotland, but other countries have run Times models, other countries have run whole energy system models, and carbon capture and storage is always included as an essential part of that whole system energy model. So we can go away and run our times model again and again for Scotland, but it will come out with the same result, that we need CCS as an essential part of that all energy system, low carbon delivery.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Come on to a question from Bill Bowman now.
Thank you, Convener. In the Scottish Government's energy strategy, it said the following, and I'll just read it because I think it's quite important. In the absence of adequate storage capacity, thermal electricity generation is required to provide important baseload capacity and support the resilience of the energy system, the electricity system, sorry. So if I can ask you, is new thermal baseload capacity necessary or desirable or both? And how this might be built given the electricity industry's current reluctance to invest in new plant?
Christine McKenzie and then Lindsay McQuaid.
It's probably more National Grid that can go into great detail on that, but from our point of view, we don't think it's problematic to security of supply that there's less thermal capacity simply in Scotland, for example, because we're part of an important GB-wide marketplace and network. The support for security of supply comes through that at the moment. But I think we would welcome increased flexibility in Scotland given the new renewable assets that are coming on stream. But I think that's probably a different topic. I think probably I'd leave it to the detail to National Grid on that.
Let's come in the back of that. The role for new thermal is challenging in Scotland and in part attributable to the transmission charging regime. And National Grid will be well placed to respond to questions on that at the later session. Clearly that there has been decommissioning of thermal sites in Scotland. But at the same time, there's also been extensive investment in the infrastructure and network to ensure that we can continue to supply customers with the energy that they need. Roughly, we are investing £3 million a day between our networks and our renewables business to ensure that the power gets to where it can be consumed. It's a lot of investment that's happening in Scotland, and we see that network continuing to work harder to transmit and get the cleaner, greener energy to our consumer base. Considering flexibility, more specifically, we've undertaken work with industry colleagues and Imperial College of London to evaluate the impact of increasing renewable generation with increased flexibility onto the network, and that considers the type of storage that goes from large scale, such as pumped hydro, through to batteries, through to domestic scale. And in essence, you need a bit of everything. There's no single technology that will solve the storage issue, but having that storage and that backup capacity allows you to make the network work much more efficiently and effectively with the renewable capacity that we've got. And that analysis, and the report's publicly available, shows that if you invest relatively moderately in flexibility, you can actually very efficiently reduce the overall costs associated with running the electricity network to the tune of something like £7 billion a year versus what we see just now. So with increasing volumes of renewable generation, as has been in part proposed by the energy strategy, with some moderate increases in improvement and flexibility, you can actually get a fully functioning network.
Hogan and then Professor Hazeldine.
Yes, I would just echo what's been said already. But yeah, just to emphasise, I think the role of storage in the system. Ofgem and BEIS have recently run a call for evidence on flexibility options for the electricity system, and energy storage has been very much a crucial part of that. Also, the UK's recent industrial strategy is very strong on storage and other forms of flexibility. So UK-wide, it's clearly seen as a key part of the mix to come, and I think that shouldn't be underestimated. And that's something that's also going to be particularly important if the strategy seems to say that we will be looking at increased electrification of rail and road and heat networks in Scotland. So I think the other thing just to highlight is the completion of the Western HVDC cable in 2016-17 or later this year, which will significantly enhance the capability of the transmission system and enable transfers from England and Wales to Scotland of up to about 3.9 gigawatts. Again, National Grid and Ofgem can give you more detail later, but just to highlight that that increased capacity will obviously have a big impact on the amount of increased generation that we can sustain in Scotland.
So I'm much less sanguine about the absence of storage capacity. And I agree that we have storage to manage variable delivery on timescales of minutes or hours or even perhaps a day with pumped storage capacity. But I think we have no ability to handle a shortfall of renewable generation over multiple days. And it's clear from weather patterns that that happens very regularly across the UK and across large parts of Europe. And it's clear that even if we relied on interconnectors of electricity generation from Europe, there are periods when the immediately surrounding 7, 8, 10 countries have no or very little renewable wind generation from those countries. So it remains an entirely unanswered question to me about how we obtain secure electricity, resilient supply without thermal generation. I think a problem we're facing is that National Grid have developed a transmission charging policy, which is a UK-wide policy, and they have a UK-wide a model for delivering electricity at a low-cost way, but that doesn't take into account regional generation patterns and regional security. And Scotland is an important region of the UK, and we've now experienced the loss of our embedded thermal capacity of generations through Longannet and Cockenzie, and Peterhead only runs part-time as backup capacity. And so it remains an entirely open question for me, and an unanswered question is what happens if there's a lull of wind with a blocking high weather system, high pressure weather system, which goes on for 4, 5, or 6 days, and we need to supply a large amount of electrified ordinary electricity. If we've supplied if we then try and electrify our rail system, we're supplying electric vehicles and we're trying to supply electrified heat, we have no ability to have the storage capacity to back that up. And so there are good reasons to suppose we should actually look at how we back that up, because at the moment we've got through the past few weeks by relying on import of electricity from the rest of the English grid through the interconnectors which already exist and through demand reduction. In future we might want to consider a regional pricing system for generation of electricity which would enable gas fuel power plant or integrated plant which could supply either electricity or hydrogen from the same plant, such as the Summit Power proposition for Grangemouth. We could choose to provide electricity or hydrogen from that, or heat from that. We could do that, and we could also provide the CO2 takeaway service for that, because it's, again, I point to the fact that there have been successive propositions for carbon capture and storage in Scotland, and that's because Scotland has all of the infrastructure to provide very easy access to developing a thermal generation plant which can take away the carbon dioxide, because we have the existing pipework infrastructure on land, we have the existing pipework infrastructure offshore, we have the storage sites assessed, ready for development, as has been spoken about by Scottish Power and Scottish and Southern Electricity from the previous UK projects. There's been well over £100 million of UK government investment in that, and we could have those systems up and running by 2020, 2021 if we wanted to. And that would be a low carbon reinforcing development to support the types of renewables electricity delivery we've heard about, and also to move forward with our heat delivery, which we haven't really solved.
Thank you. Lindsay McQuaid.
Just to pick up on a couple of points that have been made, with regard to investment in new build gas, obviously we have the capacity market that Christine mentioned earlier on as an effective tool to try and stimulate that. In part, that's the effectiveness of that policy intervention has been frustrated because of the pricing point of some of the technologies that are actually winning in that auction. So we are seeing aged plant being able to compete effectively in that auction and outstrip any development of new generation. That's of concern to us, and we would like to see that mechanism reviewed in order to bring forward what the policy was intended to do, and that was to bring forward new build gas. I think in terms of where that new build gas would be located, right now the pricing signals would tend for that to happen in areas of England and Wales, but the 4 gigawatt HVDC connection that Jenny mentioned is bidirectional, so when the wind blows in Scotland we can export to England and Wales, and when it doesn't blow in Scotland we can import generation from England and Wales. So it's a very novel power connection. The fact that it is bidirectional, that's something that we've not had in Scotland before, and in part removes some of the constraint that we've experienced. It's helpful to see that change coming through, and obviously there are plans afoot for further enhancement and upgrade of the network as well.
Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to move on to the residential sector, where we've got quite ambitious targets of 76% reduction emissions by 2032, and to ask what views you have in relation to how successful we've been since RPP 2, and whether in fact the scale of reductions that's proposed is achievable. I think, Jenny Hogan, you said that we need to accelerate this, and in your view there are technologies that are available now. I wonder if people would like to comment on that.
I think I've kind of said more or less our view anyway, but yeah, those technologies are available already. I mean, we have various forms of renewable heat, from different types of heat pumps to biomass boilers, solar thermal, and of course various district heating systems as well. Those technologies are available now, they are being installed now. I think the renewable heat incentive was mentioned earlier as the UK system, which has been recently reformed and extended. We would want to see that continued beyond 2021 in order to allow the continuation of those, the installation of those technologies. So it is unclear. There seems to be, I think, a focus mainly on energy efficiency up until 2025, and absolutely recognise energy efficiency is fundamental, so we wouldn't dispute that. But I think alongside that, we need to also see renewable heat and other low-carbon heat solutions rolled out sooner than 2025. So I'm not entirely clear on why that has been set out that way in the draft plan and strategy. It's welcome, however, that we've got the consultation on local heat strategies, which we'll certainly be responding to that consultation. And broadly speaking, I think seeing public sector take leadership in this area will be fundamental as well. So we'd like to see more detail on how public sector and local authorities can be leading in terms of renewable and low-carbon heat solutions.
I think Christine McKenzie and then Lindsay McQuaid.
Welcome the Scottish Government's decision, especially to designate energy efficiency as a national infrastructure priority. Improving the energy efficiency of housing stock, we think, is good to happen alongside decarbonisation of heat. But as district heating is one area that's explored a lot too, and SSE has done a lot of district heating UK-wide, and one of the lessons we've learned is, like, our Wynford estate in Maryhill compared to some of our London projects, I think real incentives at a building planning standards level help to incentivise that market. I think we're going to submit to the consultation as well, obviously, in more detail, but I think incentivising the private sector in Scotland around district heating would make a big difference. I think some things like a presumption in favour, potentially a code of conduct or a body that oversees district heating in Scotland would be a good way forward. And one of the key things for district heating that we've experienced is it's important to get the infrastructure in place for the district heating before worrying about what the fuel for that might be. So you might start with a fossil fuel system, but that, as long as you've got the district heating in place, that can then be switched over to a carbon-free source. So it might not all come at once, but the idea would be that it's incentivising that initial installation of the district heating. Our Wynford was a retrofit, but I think most district heating is on new builds. So those regulations at the beginning, I think, are critical to that.
Thank you. I think just to pick up on energy efficiency, there's obviously the ongoing consultation with BEIS just now on how energy efficiency and the mechanisms to support energy efficiency is running just now. Clearly that has to conclude so that we can then understand how Scotland will deal with its own energy efficiency mechanism, and we look forward to engaging with Scottish Government on that as well. I think having a view that Scotland will have responsibility for its own budget to try and manage energy efficiency schemes is something that means that we can particularly address those issues that affect Scottish-based consumers and target where it's needed. I think one ask that we would have is that we see the development of an energy efficiency market for those services. Right now we have existing schemes such as ECO, and very much that's an obligation on suppliers, retail suppliers to your consumers, and the providers of energy efficiency mechanisms understand that that's an obligation on us that we must deliver against, and it doesn't necessarily then result in the most competitive of markets. So I think having a clearer market-based mechanism would benefit the consumer in the long run, and also ensure that that budget that the Scottish Government will be given can be put to best use and targeted to where it's most required.
Okay. So I think going back to Andy Whiteman's original question, can we deliver on this? And I think, again, it stands or falls on the heat delivery. And how we deliver heat, I think we're locked into a conversation about renewable heat, warm water delivery systems, and I suspect that's going to be really expensive on a whole system basis. And again, part of the strength of the Times modelling is it will include what the infrastructure costs for delivering that heat system to lots of urban areas, what their true costs will actually be. Because it's very easy to talk about individual projects. It's very easy to talk about fitting local heat systems in new build, and all that's fine and good. And we should consider that. We should also, of course, consider improving efficiency in the existing housing stock. But again, if we go to the information we have at present in the energy strategy on page 22, we've got the graph of heat delivery. And in the winter, the heat delivery is equivalent to an extra 10 to 15 gigawatts of heat during the day and night. And that is hard to imagine delivering through renewable energy. So we have to distinguish how we're going to deliver our heat. Is it through renewable energies somehow, by building vast amounts of extra renewable energy? And then I reopen the conversation about how we back that up for delivery when there's lulls in renewables. We heard about an interconnector of 3 or 4 gigawatts, so we'd need another 3 or 4 of those interconnectors, even presupposing that we could buy the power from England at a time of low power shortage. And we also need to consider, do we want to go into an alternative energy vector such as hydrogen? And maybe we're discussing that later, I don't know. But it's premature to decide, I think, at the moment, are we going to deliver this heat through renewables, or are we going to deliver this heat through a different low carbon vector such as hydrogen? And that's a very, very big decision which this climate plan talks about as potentials, the energy plan talks about as potentials, but I don't think we're at the point where we've done the analysis enough to make a final decision on that at this point, because it's clearly possible to deliver the hydrogen system through the existing methane gas network. That's the potential possibility of that, which means that you gain the benefit of several billions of pounds of already existing pipework, which you can replace one gas with a different gas. And that makes conversion to a low carbon heat delivery system much, much easier and much, much more possible to examine. And so the relevant organisation for that would be a Scottish Gas Networks witness or evidence from Scottish Gas Networks, who are just starting on the analysis of that. So again, I'm worried that we are being put in the position of trying to choose too early before we've looked at the whole system costs and before we've looked at the true analysis of what the alternatives really are for heat delivery.
I think Jenny Hogan just wanted to come back in with a brief point there.
Just a couple of points. First of all, just I wanted to mention about business rates. So district heating schemes at the moment have been effectively penalised in the way that they are calculated, their business rates are calculated, and that's something that we've been speaking to the Scottish Government about, trying to reassess and ensure that the methodology used for business for district heating schemes is fair and reflective, and similarly for on-site generation, so for the likes of distilleries, for example, and how they use their heat and generate energy. That's something that I think needs reviewed and looked at to ensure it's fair and proportionate and helps to reduce costs. And just on that point about costs, I mean, district heating schemes are already being delivered, as Christine's highlighted. And just to touch on the point about the variability, if you like, I mean, you know, we're looking at various types of technologies here when it comes to the renewable supply. So heat pumps, for example, biomass, you know, these are not variable technologies. However, you know, we recognise that they are still relatively early stage. They are being developed in other countries and to some extent here, but there's a huge amount of potential there. Electrification is very much part of the solution, but I think that the key here is about having a mix and looking at different options, and hydrogen may well be part of that further down the line. It's obviously still at an early stage, but we, you know, we certainly welcome innovation and pilots in that area too. So I think it's about requiring there's a variety, but renewables will have to play a key role simply because we need to cut carbon, and if we, you know, we very much agree with the point that Christine made about ensuring that the infrastructure is there initially, but ultimately we will fairly soon, I think, have to ensure that that can switch over to renewables at some point or other form of very low carbon heat supply.
Thank you. And moving on to Jackie Bailey.
Yep. I was fascinated by what Stuart Hazeldine just described to us, and I'm curious if you have a sense that the Scottish Government is keeping a wide approach to looking at testing different options, or do you think they're narrowing down a particular route?
My conversations with the civil servants in the Scottish Government suggest to me that there's a very strong interest in looking at the wide approach. And so I would strongly advise the political masters of the civil servants to listen carefully to what the civil servants have to say about carrying on further analysis about the different options. And again, I'm really clear that we need to discriminate between renewable generated heat and low carbon heat. And that's a really big decision, which is not within the view or remit of any one of the any of us four witnesses here, because it's a whole national decision, which again we need to take, bearing in mind we're at the frontier of this innovation about how we're going to go down a low carbon route for Scotland as a country or as a large region of the UK, whichever way you like to look at it. And what we do will be relevant for us and our geography. There are big potential possibilities in co-benefits of hydrogen, because, and they're not included in the Times model because the model can't do everything. And by that I mean, if we go down a hydrogen route for heating and we have made available hydrogen as a energy vector in Scotland, that opens up the possibility of fuel cells for vehicles in fleet transport, for big trucks and for buses and for big transport, because hydrogen's available. It opens up the possibility of hydrogen for domestic transport for individual citizens. So it's not a certainty that we should invest in everything in electric cars, for example, because the hydrogen technology is there in other countries. It's just not, it's maybe 5 or 10 years behind in its commercialization. But we're taking decisions here which will set a trajectory or pathway for Scotland for maybe 50 or 100 years. So we shouldn't be rushing to make decisions without a true analysis of the evidence. And again, I go back to, if we want to supply hydrogen at national scale, then Scotland is uniquely well positioned to do that, because we can manufacture hydrogen from methane gas by splitting methane. That's a really well-established process you can buy in. To do that, we need to take away the carbon dioxide and store that. We can do that and create a carbon dioxide storage industry, because in Scotland, we now own the pore space offshore Andy Whiteman might know about that. Through the Crown Estate settlement, we now own that pore space, so we can try and use our energy strategy to create new profitable offshore businesses. So it's not just a single small sector we're talking about, it ramifies throughout that. And again, we can generate hydrogen from splitting gas, we can generate hydrogen from splitting coal if we want to in a coal chemical plant with zero emissions. That process was invented in Scotland or perfected in Scotland and has been used, it is in daily use in parts of North America to generate gas from coal. And we can then, with the fullness of time, as renewables become cheaper, replace those fossil fuel generating hydrogen sources with renewable generation or have dispersed renewable generation of hydrogen around Scotland. So this is a completely alternative type of vision, which can include some fossil fuels, some renewables, because renewables have a key place in our future, but also give us much greater resilience and much greater flexibility than relying on an all electric future.
Fascinating. Let me go back to the questions. I just had to divert for a minute there, convener. We've seen an alphabet soup of energy efficiency programs in the past. ECO's been mentioned. We've had HEAPs. Now we've got SEEPs. What's the difference, aside from, you know, a variation of the alphabet? And do you think it's the right approach? And what else could we do? Anybody?
Who would like to take the alphabet question? Lindsay McQuaid.
I sympathise with the confusion that these the multitude of acronyms can cause. I think for us, we would like to see greater consistency in how energy efficiency is approached. It's not an easy one to solve. And I think as part of that, we would also like to see clarity around the definition of fuel poverty to ensure that help is directed to where it's most needed, and that sometimes these mechanisms that are set up doesn't necessarily mean that the funding is directed to those consumers that actually do require assistance with their energy consumption. So I think given that there is that ongoing review of the definition of fuel poverty, that's something we would like to see concluded, and then we can work towards it. Going back to the comment I made previously about Scottish Government now having control of its own energy efficiency mechanism, given that I represent a national supplier with consumers based across the United Kingdom as well, we would like to see some consistency between the mechanisms that, with regard to energy efficiency, that will operate in England and Wales as well as Scotland, so that we can ensure that we can deliver best value for consumers and use the budgets that that have been associated with energy efficiency most effectively.
Thank you. Professor Hazelt?
I'm not going to be very detailed on this, except to say that energy efficiency is a key metric of decarbonising your economy. And recent global analyses show that how efficiently and how lower carbon you can make your energy system is the critical pathway towards arriving at net zero for 2020 and 2032, so staging point on the way. I don't really mind how that's delivered, which bit of the alphabet delivers it, but we should be careful that I noticed that the way it was attempted to be delivered through the Green Deal or whatever it was called in England was very not successful, because it was basically a totally uncompetitive pricing mechanism, and a house owner could borrow money at a much less cost and make their own energy efficiency alterations compared to a greater cost from the so-called help from the government, whereas the Scottish system of a much more direct price support and much more direct help for homeowners or home dwellers worked a lot better. So I think we've got a good track record. We should, and this is, again, a long-term proposition. This is a 10 or 20-year proposition to produce much greater efficiency in our housing and in our transport and gradually in our industries and businesses as well.
Thank you. Richard Leonard.
If I could come back to the domestic heating market, two of the most valued qualities in politics are honesty and credibility. And one of the proposals in the Scottish Government's plan and strategy is that we will switch from an 80% reliance on gas today for domestic heating to, in 15 years' time, an 80% reliance on low-carbon technologies. I mean, as I look around, gas smart meters are still being installed, gas boilers are still being put in households, the gas network is still being improved and invested in. How are we going to go from a position of 80% reliance on gas to 80% reliance on low-carbon technologies in just 15 years' time? I'm asking all of you.
Well, if I go first this time, then I think that's clearly really, really difficult thing to do. And part of that is a demand reduction, which we've already had success in demand reduction over since about 2005 or something. We've had a 15% demand reduction, partly through more efficient appliances, partly through insulation and efficiency of houses. We can anticipate maybe 10% or more demand reduction and behaviour change. So some help will come from that. And that's partly a low-cost fitting of houses and partly an education programme. But there's, you know, that's a limited gain. So if you should go to, if you go to a low-carbon option, if that includes hydrogen, you could deliver that in 15 years, but it would be really, it's really quite ambitious to do that. But there's no harm in having ambition because that stretches people. And we've discovered that through having ambition, the cost of renewables has plummeted and the rate of delivery of renewables has increased. So high ambition, as we've said right at the start of this whole meeting, high ambition is a very good pull through to help that. I don't know whether you could achieve the build of renewable electricity in that timescale with identifying the sites, actually constructing the equipment. Because remember, to do this, you'll need 10 to 15 gigawatts effectively of actual supply. So you'll need 45 gigawatts of capacity from renewables to deliver that. And I don't know if anybody in the delivery companies has got any idea at all how they're going to deliver that. So if I personally had to make the decision, I would say we'll have to have a moonshot project on converting the gas network to hydrogen, because I could buy in some hydrogen generation equipment off the market and have that built within 3 to 4 years. I could reopen the Feeder 10 pipeline from central Scotland to St Fergus and take away the CO2 from generating that hydrogen and dispose of that CO2 offshore to make the low carbon ambition be achieved, and we could do that by 2020. So yes, I could deliver that in 15 years, but we'd have to know that that was a strong direction we were going to go in.
Thank you. Jenny Hogan.
Similarly, I think I would echo your incredulation, if that's the right word, in terms of it is a huge amount of ambition, and I think it is very stretching. However, I agree with Stuart that, you know, we welcome that ambition, and I think that's certainly a good place to start. First of all, I think it's worth just highlighting that it's quite hard to see from the plan, the draft plan and the draft strategy, exactly what the impact of each policy will be. So, for example, how much of the energy efficiency measures that are planned would bring down the actual heat supply that would then be required? How much is electrification likely to play a role, and what would that therefore mean for what's left over? But in terms of the types of things that will need to come into play, so we've talked about district heating already, and that will need regulation as soon as possible. I mentioned business rates as well, which will be key to that. Building standards, a huge amount of improvement I think we can still make there. There's a bioenergy action plan consultation mentioned in the draft climate change plan, which will come, I think, after the climate change plan is completed. Again, what's going to be involved in that? I think that will be crucial to how much of a role that biomass can play. The planning system will have a great role to play. So looking at examples like the London plan, for example, and the really quite transformative changes that they've managed to make, and how can we learn from those types of systems. Continuation of funding, of course. So REEF, for example, is mentioned along with other funding schemes. I think as well, we're expecting to see the UK's emission reduction plan sometime in the spring, we hope. And clearly the UK has got a long way to go in terms of heat and transport, and there's not much sign yet other than continuation of the renewable heat incentive for how they are going to make those great changes. So I think that will also give us some clues, maybe touching on the point about hydrogen. You know, hydrogen does need to be really system-wide, UK-wide, I think, to really succeed. So there might be some clues in what we can see the UK doing to, and how Scotland can kind of link up with that. I think I also mentioned public sector leadership earlier, and again, I think that's going to be crucial. So what more can the public sector do to champion and show the way for renewable and low-carbon heat in particular, and help drive that market forward? So I think that's enough to start with for now.
Thank you. Professor Hazeldine, you wanted to come back?
Slightly, because I think what we've just heard is that we actually really need to do the arithmetic on the feasibility of the delivery of all that. So if there's a certain amount of conversation about there are various policies and strategies and plans and whatever, but it still comes back to, as a part of the as a region of the UK, if we wanted to decarbonise heat through renewable generation, we need to build an immense amount of renewable electricity generation to do that, and the arithmetic on that does not stack up in my view. And so I welcome the challenge, but I would like to see some sort of arithmetic for the delivery of that. And, you know, maybe we're just not prepared for that and we should send in some extra information afterwards, and that's fine. But it didn't sound like we had a very clear answer, either of us, really. But I think we've worked through a little bit on the hydrogen delivery, so we'll very happily send in information for that. We've not worked through the renewable delivery option, so I can't speak for that personally. I would welcome the information.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Just a very quick follow-up. So are Scottish Power, for example, and SSE actively looking at district heating or actively looking at hydrogen as an alternative fuel source?
As I said earlier, we already have quite a few district heating schemes across the UK in place, and pilot in Maryhill at Wynford. But I suppose the thing to remember is we as energy companies are participants in a marketplace, and we have a regulator, we have government that drive the direction of policy. And you know, anything can be achieved if you really have the right incentives and laws in place to make it happen. But I suppose at the moment this is a thinking stage of where exactly should we be going, and we're happy to participate in our using our obviously lots of business expertise in SSE in terms of thoughts, but ultimately we're a participant in a marketplace, and we must abide by what policy is decided. So I guess we're working where we can on pilot projects. We're working with like housing associations. We're working with a number of social housing providers to try and make district heating happen, and private sector down south and the building industry too. So we are working towards it, but we're exploring a range of business options. It's not just that, but as I said earlier, we welcome that the Scottish Government has put this forward as a priority.
Lindsay McQuaid.
I would agree that it's an ambitious target, and I think the person at the end of this change in approach is the consumer. We all value being able to heat our homes and control that flexibility as well. So whatever the solution will be with regard to decarbonisation of heat, it has to be something that the consumer is willing to adopt and accept. And I think aside from the arithmetic that we need to do as to what that optimal mix is going to be, is about motivating and promoting the change in consumer behaviour that we'll need so that they will willingly adopt a lower carbon form of heat generation. That should hopefully then allow us to achieve the targets that have been set out. But yes, 15 years with that ambition in mind does seem challenging. There are obviously workshops and various pieces of analysis running. I believe there's a workshop this Thursday, in fact, that we'll be attending to discuss renewable heat. So it's something, again, that we are very keen on understanding more about, and trying to shape out where we can best use our expertise as an energy retailer to service that requirement.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank all of our witnesses for coming in today. We'll bring this session to a close, and also invite all of the witnesses to make further submissions in writing on any points that they would like to, or indeed perhaps on the last points mentioned by Professor Hazeldine. So thank you very much for coming, and we'll allow the current witnesses to leave and our next witnesses to take the panel. Thank you. Well, good morning, and thank you. We'll recommence our session with our second panel this morning. If I could thank our witnesses for coming in this morning. As you're aware, we're discussing the Scottish Government's climate change plan and energy strategy. If I might introduce our next witnesses, from left to right, first of all, Nicola Pitts, who is the head of commercial frameworks gas for the National Grid. Next, we have Julian Leslie, who is the head of electricity network development, National Grid, followed by Kirsty Berg, who is the partner in networks and the head of Ofgem in Scotland. And finally, but not least, Andy Burgess, who is associate partner of Energy Systems Integration, Ofgem. If I might just start, I think some of you were in for the previous session, so you'll have heard at least some of the evidence from the previous witnesses. I'm interested in your views on how the new plan relates to the previous plan, how feasible and realistic the targets set out in it are, and finally, and perhaps most importantly, what new opportunities does it present for the Scottish Government to develop and move things forward within the current framework here in Scotland? I'm not sure who would like to start off on those three questions. Nicola Pitts.
Very much welcome the plan and the strategy, and very much welcome the fact that it's a multi-strand approach. And I think the challenge that we all have is what are the multiple levers that we can pull, not just the few. I also welcome the fact that it's very positive about new technology, and I feel that probably over the next decade we need to enter into a period of active experimentation, and we've talked about some of the technologies here, in order to make the shift. I think the challenge, and it very much came out in the last session, is around how do we decarbonise heat, particularly if we only focus on the household, and how we get that cost and convenience that makes it palatable for households to change within the timescales. And I think if we look at our history of adoption, which I'm very happy to go into later if you would like, that has been particularly slow. So we might want to think of other options as to how we decarbonise heat rather than just focus on the household.
Kirsty Berg.
I come in for Ofgem. Likewise, we very much welcome the Scottish Government's plan and the energy strategy. In terms of your first question on feasibility of the targets, that's not really for us to comment on. That is very much the governments, both the UK government and the Scottish government, set the targets. But what we need to make sure, as for the regulator and National Grid as well, is to make sure that the market arrangements, both in the markets and the arrangements covering network investments, are fit for purpose to enable that strategy. So we just need to be very clear about what our role is in this, as opposed to government that sets targets and holds the biggest policy levers to implement these targets.
Thank you. We'll come now to questions from Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. Policy outcome one in the climate change plan for electricity is to get the grid intensity down to below 50 grams of carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour. Given the Department of Energy climate change best case scenario was published early last year, suggested that we might get to 100 grams per 2030. Is 50 too ambitious, and how do we actually assess the extent to which we're getting to 50 in Scotland when we have a GB-wide grid?
So it is a GB-wide grid, and I guess one of my observations around the plan is that we must remember this is a GB network, is a GB grid, and therefore a lot of the services and products that are in the plan are also available across the rest of GB. Obviously, you can measure, and we can measure, the energy consumption within Scotland. We can compare that to the energy production within Scotland, which the two are disaligned. You're consuming power based on consumer behaviour, whereas the production of power goes with the weather. So you can do that trade-off to say, well, actually, how many terawatt-hours of energy have you consumed? how many terawatt hours of energy have you delivered through renewables, and you could do that equation. The bulk of the time, a lot of the wind power, and it is wind in Scotland, is going south into England and Wales. And then on days like today, and certainly through last summer, you were importing a lot of energy from England and Wales, so it's going the other way to make up for that shortfall. So I guess it just depends on the benchmark as to how you want to consider energy consumption. Is it the time of use, carbon intensity, and that will vary through the year, or are you just looking at your total volume of energy consumed against the total volume of energy generated, even though the two may not match, and you can make a carbon assessment on that. So I think you'd need to be very clear as to how you're going to and what basis that 50 grams is going to be calculated.
So you're saying, in other words, that it's a legitimate and indeed a valid target, but it's not clear how it's going to be calculated.
Correct.
As to whether we've succeeded
or not. You calculate it one way and you have a very, very low carbon intensity. You calculate the other way, which is actually of every kilowatt hour consumed throughout the year, where the source of that energy came from, then your intensity is much higher.
But you're saying it's possible to do that?
Yes.
Yep. Okay. That's fine. That addresses that question. Thank you very much.
Right. Gillian Martin had a supplementary to that question.
Yeah, supplementary based on what you're talking about being a GB-wide grid, specifically for Mr. Leslie. Something happened last week. Peterhead Power Station was penalised with higher costs in the capacity market auction because of its geographical location in the northeast. If it's a GB-wide grid, and Peterhead's obviously the only power station producing into that grid, how can that be justified? How can it be justified that you've got a GB-based power station that's been penalised because of its geographical location?
So it is a GB-wide market. Obviously, the capacity auction allows all generation that meets the criteria to submit their price into the auction, and then we run that process, and then they get selected. In terms of meeting network security, Peterhead is an option, and obviously it is a locational option in Scotland. However, we could meet the security of the grid without that power station being in place from a network security point of view. The capacity mechanism is only one contract of many, and obviously that's commercially sensitive information, so we can't divulge that here. But it is only one contract that it could be successful in, and a range of other services that it provides to the grid.
But does that not threaten the security of a plant like Peterhead if, because of its geographical location, that it's unable to compete because of being penalised by transmission costs?
Well, it's not being penalised. There's a locational charging regime in GB. There's a lot of assets between Peterhead and where most of the demand is consumed. And therefore, there's a lot of network investment that happens on the back of that. So locational charging is something which we have in the UK. All the generators are subject to that equally. And it's a competitive commercial decision for SSE and how they bid and how they play in that market.
I'll move on to a question from John Mason.
Thanks, Convener. Again, at the previous session, we had a bit of discussion around the installed renewable capacity, and there's been various figures flowing around, and I just was questioning witnesses, so I'd like to question you as well. The energy strategy talks about, indicates that between 11 and 17 gigawatts of installed renewable capacity will be required by 2030. And then we also had the UK Committee on Climate Change highlighting a significant increase in the rate of renewable energy installation. I mean, they were saying that by 2020, we would need between 14 and 16 gigawatts, and we'd need to increase the rate of deployment to 1.3 gigawatts per year. Are these figures that you kind of recognise? And I don't know if it's something you can comment on.
So I might hand over to National Grid on this one. So National Grid forecast a range of scenarios for how the energy system is going to develop. And many parties, industry and transmission companies and ourselves use these scenarios. So it may be best to answer that question in the context of that scenario work.
Sure. So National Grid produce four energy scenarios each year, as Kirsty just said. One, which is we meet the UK's government targets of the 34% renewables by 2020. We're on track to deliver that across GB-wide. We also produce other scenarios going beyond 2020, which look at, we meet the environmental targets, but maybe 1 or 2 years late, so that's called slow progression. We have another, which is no progression, which actually we just have a focus on conventional power plants, and we move away from that renewable focus. And we have something called consumer power, which is where we have a very booming economy, and people are electing to buy renewable goods and renewable products and switch to renewable energy because they can afford to do so and it's the right thing to do. And that allows us to give us a credible range of envelope in which to plan and operate our network in looking forward, going all the way out to sort of the mid-2030s in detail and then going out to 2050 at a higher level. So we have this broad range of scenarios which we're hoping to head into. All of our processes then that sit behind that, the National Grid operate in terms of network investment, use that range of credible scenarios in order to test what investments should be made and when to make sure we get the most efficient energy network, electricity network, sort of invested in and delivered just in time to sort of manage the constraints and be there ready to deliver the renewable objectives onto the network. So in terms of the numbers, I mean, today we're sat in Scotland with 11.5 gigawatts of total generation contracted, but that does include Peterhead and the two nuclear stations. There's another 5 gigawatts out there which is consented, but it isn't coming forward at this point because it doesn't have any form of renewables incentive. And then there's another 6 gigawatts out there which has a contract with National Grid but is yet to go through the consenting process. So we have a whole pipeline of a further 11 gigawatts of generation which we have contact with, we have a contract with, so that as and when the environment is in the right place, sort of economic environment is in the right place, that those projects are willing and able and ready to come forward to connect. So that would bring total Scotland generation to around 22 gigawatts if all that came to fruition against a peak demand, which is for 1.5 an hour a year of 5.4 gigawatts. So you already double your peak demand, and there's projects out there which would take you to quadruple your peak demand in terms of installed generation from renewables.
So how do, can you explain to me, how does the relationship work between what you decide as to where we're going over 10, 20, 15 years, whatever it is, and the likes of SSE and Scottish Power and all of them about investing in other capacity? Is it purely through the contract mechanism? Is that how it all works?
No, so our scenarios aren't they're just a view of the future. It's not a plan. It's not a direction. It's just giving us the ability to understand the range of possible future outcomes. But obviously that is impacted hugely by policy. It's hugely impacted by market conditions, and that's where SSE and SP, they're looking at those market conditions, looking at the technologies and the cost of those technologies, looking at the policy direction, but it's down to the developers to decide where and when to invest in what technology.
So are they, would you say they were guided by your view, even though it's not your plan, that your view of the future requirements...
It'd be part of one of their many, many inputs. It'd be one of their many inputs to have a look at that, to get National Grid's views to where things are going.
Yeah. Just if I can come in on that point. So National Grid, as the system operator, provides it. So the parties that actually invest and build generation plant are private sector companies. So they will do that based on the commercial viability of their plant. So they actually take the decisions of what to invest in, you know, be that thermal plant or be that renewable plant. But what is important, and there's been some changes in the way in the sort of energy market setup recently, is that there is somebody who provides some overview of plausible future scenarios, making assumptions about who's going to invest where and when, which is what Julian was talking about. So there's a bit into to-ing and fro-ing. Yes, the developers will look at National Grid scenario, but fundamentally what they look at when they decide to invest is this a viable plant in light of sort of future market conditions or any support there may be from government and other sources.
And then is Ofgem commenting on their assumptions or their decision-making?
The company's decision making.
Yes.
Not directly. So our role is manifold, but primarily twofold. So we need to ensure that there is competition in the parts of the market that are competitive. So in the supply market and the generation market. What we're also responsible for doing is making sure that the network companies, so in electricity, the transmission operators and the companies that operate the smaller distribution network line, that they invest efficiently. So they need to think about what are the plausible scenarios, what is the generation that's going to come on, and in light of that, what kind of network should we build where? So that the point of this is that the scenarios that Julian is talking about helps a range of market participants, including ourselves, understand what the future looks like. It is a consultative process, so there's some real sort of challenge to what National Grid present, and I think you will often change your scenarios in light of challenge from the consultation process. But I do think it's quite helpful. You know, it's not centrally planned, but that somebody provides a fairly authoritative view on a range of different futures of what the energy system may look like.
Okay, thanks so much.
Gil Patterson.
Thanks very much. Convener, it's a question I raised in the last session, and I would like to continue that with regards to the Scottish Government reaching its target and the fact that subsidies have been taken away. And would the private sector be able to breach that gap and assist? But the follow-up that I didn't make, and I apologise to the folk at the time, I never get the opportunity to, would the answer be perhaps, probably get sacked for this, if they could sack me, that since capital is a question here, because it's big money that we're talking about right down the line, that a scheme for governments to underwrite the capital, is that happening or could that happen?
I mean, that is very much a question for government, whether they want to. So underwriting capital, I suppose, is another form of support. You can have a range of support mechanisms. You can have direct subsidies, and you can underwrite the cost of capital. And the decision as to, as I said at the start, the decision as to what targets the government wants in terms of meeting climate change targets, and then the high-level policies it wants to support to use in order to achieve these are very much matters for government. So the extent to which government wants to use subsidy tools, that's for government. That's not not really for us to comment on.
I suppose what I'm asking would that, since I think the answer I got that private industry couldn't quite make up that difference. It'd be challenging mm-hmm. for them. So effectively, I'm asking, would that assist? Would that be a request that we should consider as a parliament? Is that something that may make the difference if it was available?
I think the main thing that business wants, and obviously National Grid is a PLC as well, wants a stable investment climate, and if possible, the furthest look ahead as to what those government policies may be, in order for them to take the scenarios and then work out the market dynamics around that. Obviously, if you do have changing government policies or wider economic disruption, then that tends to delay or halt investment decisions. So I think if there was a stable economic climate and stable government policy that was far enough ahead, then that would produce enough signals for business to come forward and make those final investment decisions.
Okay. Thanks for that. And I've got another question. It's in regards, I don't know if anyone got the Herald yesterday, and there's a question in there a letter about renewable technologies actually adding to CO2 emissions rather than reducing them. And if I could just, convener, just take a slice from that letter, which is really interesting. Almost all wind turbines are induction generators, and as the name suggests, induce relatively small electrical currents from the UK national grids, so that when the wind blows, these currents are effectively amplified and are added to the national grid's capacity. Unfortunately, because of the blustery nature of the wind, this amplified electricity is of such poor quality that the grid will collapse, as it cannot handle more than 10% of the corrupting junk electricity at any moment in time. And I see you all smiling, and you know, I was having a wee laugh when I read this too, but my background would suggest that's a spoof letter, or maybe it's fake news, but I just wondered if you could clarify it and put it in the record what you think.
So it is a spurious letter. The power that's generated by a wind turbine, it goes through a whole bunch of power electronics before it comes onto our network. Therefore, the power received from whatever source of generation meets the required standards, industry standards. And therefore, whatever is happening within the turbine, because it is true, it is a low-grade power, but by the time it meets the grid, it is of a high standard quality that meets the UK regulations on delivering that. On Christmas Day, we had 47% of the entire nation's energy supplied by renewable generation. So to say we can't do any more than 10% is just not true. So 47% is the highest sustained period of renewable generation we've ever had in the UK.
Yeah, smashing. Great answer. Thanks for that.
Thank you. We'll move on to Gillian Martin.
So we were talking in the last session about carbon capture and storage, and I get a sense that we've got a real problem on our hands here, given that the technology hasn't been developed to a state yet. And of course, the funding research was taken away about 18 months ago. It affected my area greatly, with me just being on the border of Peterhead. A lot of people really quite keen to be at the forefront of that technology in the area. What other options do you think, in your expertise, are available if this technology isn't developed? It has been mentioned, that, of course, that CCS doesn't appear in the UK government's plans and their strategy. And what are the regulator and the system operator doing to help facilitate the development of this technology, given that the Times system came up with it, and we heard from the last session that every scenario comes up with CCS being crucial in the delivery of these targets?
So the scenarios that Julian spoke about, the ones that meet the 2050 carbon targets, do have an element of carbon capture and storage. I'm also leading a project within National Grid to look at the future of gas transmission, and even looking at some of the medium and higher cases than those would cover, would need to have carbon capture and storage within them as well. As I understand it, the elements that are needed for carbon capture and storage are all proven within themselves. What hasn't been proven is perhaps that end-to-end process. We certainly think that we should be testing the viability of it. And there's some research that the ETI did, which said that without carbon capture and storage, that to meet our carbon targets would add sort of 30 to 40 billion along to the cost of that. So it does crop up in most of the studies that you look at. It's a question of how we test the viability of that and the scalability of that. And back to one of the previous panel, you know, at what levels as well. There's some interesting technology that was mentioned before, which is converting, you know, the potential to convert Leeds to a hydrogen city, but that would require carbon capture and storage. So I go back to my opening comments about, you know, I feel that over the next decade as a whole, industry and policymakers should be looking forward to how could we experiment in different types of technology, because I think that's what will take us forward more broadly.
Of course, I mean, did we miss a trick with cancelling that project in the likes of Peterhead? I mean, it's obviously going to take some government investment in terms of research funding, particularly in the light of Brexit,
to get us to where we want to be. So, I mean, how, what kind of message do you, as obviously the system and the regulator, have to governments about the investment in this kind of technology to get us where we need to be?
So I feel the competition ended abruptly. And back to my previous comments about investment certainty, then I think it would take some signal from the government for people to look at that as a serious option again.
So you would like to see that study maybe been brought back on?
Or carbon capture and storage, or indeed carbon capture and use, mm-hmm. to be reconsidered.
Okay.
And if I could just come in with a sort of broader point. So I guess we're agnostic on carbon capture storage. I think everything we've heard means that it could be a game changer, but it's not certain when it could become viable. And obviously, it'll be a question of exploring when that might be. But I think it's important not to put all our eggs in one basket. So it's important not to plan for something which might be uncertain. You have to plan for uncertainty generally, but basically explore different ways of doing things, which is why recently we've been looking at something called flexibility, so how you make better use of the energy that we have today, and that's through exploring storage, exploring demand-side response, so using energy at different times to even out the load across the system, exploring the way in which technology can improve management of networks, and generally exploring how the system can evolve with new forms of technology, new ways of doing things. And that could include hydrogen, it could include CCS in future, but it's important not to just follow one path and to allow for different possibilities. Yeah. Because I think there are probably technological developments out there that we don't know about.
Sure, today, I absolutely get that. But CCS and the Times model has come out, and the climate change plan specifically has mentioned that CCS is a vital part of that, and that variety of solutions to stopping carbon emissions. Yeah. I don't have anything else to ask.
Ash Denham.
Thank you. So we know from the plan that decarbonising heat is going to be a significant part of, you know, achieving the goals that we want to achieve. We've currently got a very large gas network set up. So if we want to go about repurposing that, maybe to biomass or maybe to hydrogen, I'm just seeking the panel's views on what they think would be the regulatory or maybe the system barriers to doing that.
Fortuitously, at the local level, there's been quite a mains replacement programme going on. In the case of hydrogen, being able to transport hydrogen at the local level, that would be much, you know, that is viable to do. With the plastic pipe network, we looking at the transmission system, as in the sort of very much the bulk transfer, are looking and are doing project at the moment to look at what impact that would have on both our pipe work, which tends to be steel, but also on our compressor network, which is the fleet that sort of pushes the gas around the network. So we are looking at that. There's in terms of the frameworks, we have something called the Gas Safety Management Regulations, which cover gas quality, which sounds a little dull, but it's extremely important. And that looks at almost the composition of gas. And essentially, it replicates what we found in the continental shelf when we transitioned to gas. That framework, which is under the Health and Safety Executive, has been amended over time to allow things like biogases to come forward. There's also some European standards that are very different to our own. And so there's a study which is going on at the moment to look at those gas qualities and to really look as to whether we should move away from those, either whether to a sort of wider specification that would have advantages with being able to bring forward different types of technologies, or potentially be more attractive for people to bring different types of gases to Britain more generally. So that's one example of the frameworks that we would need. If we went down a hydrogen route, then we've talked about how do we actually change over that. You would probably need some form of carbon capture and storage regime to take that carbon from the area as well. And more generally, we are looking at whether there is a product that we could deploy at a transmission level, which is a smaller, more agile connection. But we also need to think about how we also change our frameworks and commercial regimes to not just make it a quick connection in terms of the asset, but also a quick connection in terms of the frameworks that go with it. So there's lots of things that we can do to bring these forward. And you know, I talked before about us experimenting in terms of the technologies. We also need to look at the frameworks to make sure that they are ready in time for those technologies to come forward.
Very important question. I mean, it's the big question for Scotland. Scotland has decarbonised mostly decarbonised electricity supply, which is I think where you're coming from. But how the heat is going to be decarbonised is the big question and uncertainty in the future. And we're working on this. We're starting our strategy work for the next set of price controls. So for the monopoly networks, we set price controls, and currently they run for 8 years. And for gas, the next one is going to start in 2021, 22, I think. But we're already starting to think alongside with industry, what might the network look like in the future? Because with heat, we've got a range of options. So you may have local district heating systems, or you may have the gas network as it is, or you may have the gas network with more sort of cleaner gas, biogas, or you may have the gas network with a significant amount of hydrogen in. And nobody knows yet exactly what it will look like. So that's why it's important that parties, including the network companies, innovate to see how well different, what works and what doesn't, to put it simply. And that was some of the examples you were talking through. So hydrogen is obviously something people talk a lot about. How much hydrogen can you safely put onto the network? Mm-hmm. And there's the project in Leeds is probably the most famous one that's trialling this. And in our work as the monopoly regulator, we've been very actively encouraging the companies to trial and innovate things. Monopoly companies are not famed for being innovators, because unlike companies in the market sector, they can't steal other people's customers. So we actually have to put in place incentives. This is a bit unfair in the companies, but we've put in place incentives for them to innovate, partly by making the price control longer so that they can get some of the returns for their innovation, but also very importantly through our network innovation competition, where we hand out around $70 million a year to get the companies to innovate, and trialing gas on the hydrogen network has been one. Another one is on gas quality, seeing how can you manage with slightly lower gas quality standards. Now that might sound a little bit scary, but I'm sure we'll come on to it. It's important that you get the balance between what is cost effective and may work in the future alongside the environmental targets. So the gas quality issue, you can, you know, potentially bring down costs for consumers, and you can improve the environmental quality of the gas, basically, that goes through the pipes.
Just to add to that, one of the technologies which has probably been trialled a bit more in Europe, which is power to gas, so essentially soaking up excess renewables to create hydrogen to be injected into the gas pipes. And if you do that at scale, you can then almost sort of blend some of the gas quality issues away. So that's, for example, a project that we are looking at whether that's one for us to take forward under one of the network competitions. But back to frameworks, I think that also starts to bring out the issues around how the gas and electricity frameworks perhaps need to come together and operate in tandem, at a wholesale level as we see more gas-fired generation, and you get some of the opportunities of how we work both the gas and electricity systems together to create the right outcome for consumers on energy as a whole.
So obviously if we want to stay on target, we need to be decarbonising heat within, or significantly within, the sort of next 15-year sort of time frame. So for a layperson to understand, how easy would it be to start injecting hydrogen into the gas network now?
So we would need to go through that process of looking at gas quality to make sure that it was safe. But there's a project already underway to look at that. You would then need some primary legislation to change the gas safety management.
But you think it's feasible within that time frame?
Thank you. Jackie Bailey.
Just a small point, because I think Kirsty Burge invited this. We've got, you know, opportunities for lots of different new technologies, some we're not even aware of. It is the cost to the consumer that I think we've left out of this discussion. And I wonder, is it Ofgem's role? Whose role is it to actually say, do you know what, this is going to be too expensive, and there is a cut-off point at which we have to balance what we do in the future?
Shall I go first on this? It's hugely important, and yes, that was a bit of an opening, because I think you're dead right. It's hugely important. I mean, this is all about providing things for consumers, you know, who care about environmental targets, but also care about costs. Whose responsibility is it? It goes back to my point about, so the government sets the targets. The Scottish Government and the UK Government sets the targets. They also control the policy, the very big policy instruments to meet these targets. So they decide how much subsidies you may want for particular types of renewable generation, nuclear plant. That's very much a government decision that we don't have a part in. But as the regulator, Ofgem, we are also responsible for part of the cost chain. And our role is to make sure that the market arrangements facilitate investment and use of the network and the cost of the network in the most efficient way. So we need to work out what do future scenarios look like. Our big focus on this is to have a level playing field in terms of anything that happens on the network and how the network facilitates connection of different generation. Our focus is on having a level playing field, because we and government and other parties get lobbied by lots of different parties who want support for their technologies. And that can be, you know, it can be nuclear, it can be marine, it can be CCS, it can be wind. But what's helpful for consumers is that, you know, the best, it's simplifying somewhat, but the most efficient technology that is needed to manage the transition to the new system wins out. And ensuring sort of access to the network and keeping the costs of the network down, that is very much, that is our role, alongside obviously the parties that build the network.
Thank you.
We'll move on to a question from Richard Leonard.
Yep, I've got a broader question, but I wonder whether I could come back to Peter Head, because energy supply is a strategic part of any economy, and you've mentioned a few times about new fossil fuel power stations being built in other parts of Britain. I mean, presumably these are gas-fired stations predominantly in England. Where's the strategic sense of, because as I understand it from this morning's papers, SSE are talking about Peterhead closing down. Where's the strategic sense in closing down an already existing gas-fired power station and then building new ones elsewhere in the grid? I just really don't understand strategically, from a national point of view, what sense that makes.
From a UK point of view, the capacity mechanism is set by government, it's set by BEIS as to what it is, their strategy as to what it's trying to purchase through their auction. And obviously, they're back to consumer bills. That auction is running and delivering secure sources of energy at a very, very low cost. That means that even the larger transmission-connected new generation within England and Wales isn't also winning contracts. So it's not just large generation in Scotland, it's also large generation across England and Wales. What it is favouring existing diesel and gas reciprocating engines, which are already built in a lot of cases because they're supporting hospitals, they're supporting industry, and they're their backup generations. And now there's another revenue stream for these industries and for these hospitals for an already existing asset. It's also true, though, it is triggering some new build small gas reciprocating engines, some new build small diesel engines as well. And ultimately that combines together to give the 50 gigawatts of capacity, or circa 50 gigawatts of capacity, that we believe, at working with the government, is the right level of capacity to ensure that we have a safe and secure energy network within GB.
But in times gone by, and I'm not harking back all that far, but in times gone by, there was a kind of regional dimension, wasn't there, to the electricity market? And going back to the days when it was in public ownership, you had the Hydro Board and Scottish South of Scotland Electricity Board, and then the regional companies across England, for example. Do you not see there to be any purpose in having any kind of regional strategic dimension to the supply of...
Well, I need to ensure that we have a safe and secure network that can deliver the energy required under any circumstance. So we've just done a huge piece of work, working very closely with the Scottish companies, Scottish TOs, transmission owners, to look at even a post-Hunterston, Torness, post-Peterhead world, to say, will we have the existing network, plus the reinforcements that are coming, will that network be able to supply the energy demands under a no wind, under a high wind, under a low water, high water scenario? And the conclusion to that work is that yes, we can. So it's back to my point. You're part of an integrated GB transmission network. Therefore, the energy that you need in Scotland can be supplied as part of a GB network.
And is that report available? Is it published?
So it's part of the Scottish Energy Advisory Board. It's an action we took from that. We're reporting back to them on the 16th of February. And following that, there'll be a series of publications that will follow. But there's two documents which are in the public domain. One is Electricity 10-Year Statement, which was published on the 30th of November, and one which was published last Monday, which is a Network Optioneering Assessment, which looks at the future range of scenarios that we've talked about already, overlays the network capability required on those, which is the Electricity 10-Year Statement, so you can see where the pinch points are. And then the Network Optioneering Assessment, which is what we published last Monday, details then the associated investment that meets that future range of scenarios. And what is, back to the consumer point of view, what is the economic way that we can invest with the transmission companies to ensure we have a network that's fit for the future, whilst ensuring we meet all the requirements for meeting demand? I mean, you've got a 5.5 gigawatt demand in Scotland peak. That's for 1/2 an hour each year. By the time that we get to the end of this year, you'll have a 6 gigawatt import capacity once Western HVDC is built. So for that 1/2 an hour, we've already got a 500 megawatt surplus. Plus, you'll always have some hydro. There'll always be a bit of wind blowing somewhere. So there's more than enough margin now to meet your future demands in Scotland without any form of generation.
Yeah, so I mean, the sense I'm getting from this and from other evidence that we've heard from previous witnesses is that Scotland is moving to a position where it will be considerably dependent upon renewables in the post-Torness-Hunterston phase, exclusively, presumably, on renewables, but will be reliant on nuclear power and gas-fired generation from other parts of the GB market. Is that how you see it from a national grid point of view?
It is a GB market, so... the economic forces and the frameworks and the rules are determining the most economic solution to ensure we can meet the GB energy needs. And that is what we're investing in our network to ensure that the future network is capable of that as the generation sources are moving. But yeah, absolutely, this is on a GB-wide basis that your needs will be met within Scotland. You could export up to 6 gigawatts, which you need to do on a very windy day because you won't have the demand. We've got all the generation. Then on the day when the wind stops blowing, you can import energy from England and Wales, whatever form of that might be. And with future and growing interconnection with Europe as well, we will also have access to other renewable sources across Europe that will then flow into England and then meet that national demand.
Okay.
Thank you. Bill Bowman.
I'll ask the question that I asked the last time, but I think maybe you've touched on some of the parts of it. So the Scottish Government energy strategy said that in the absence of adequate storage capacity, thermal electricity generation is required to provide important baseload capacity and support the resilience of the electricity system. Now, the question I asked then was whether new thermal baseload capacity is necessary or desirable and how it might be built given the electricity industry's current reluctance to invest in new plant? And the answer, I think, that most of the, or at least three of the previous panels said, was they pointed to the National Grid and said, oh, you know, the way you cost it, it doesn't make sense for us to do this. And maybe following up on Julian Martin's point earlier, talking about the geographic basis of charging, I mean, is this something you need to look at again then?
So we're a firm believer in locational charges across GB. However, we do believe that with the rapid change in nature of generation on the network and how it's now used and a move to decentralised generation as well, that we think that the time is now, and we've started work on looking at a holistic charging review to work out what is the most economic and cost-effective way to charge for access to the transmission network, but also to try and to roll in access to the distribution network as well. Because there's two networks. There's a transmission network, like the motorways are the transmission network, and then there's the distribution, which is like your A and B roads. So making sure that, because there's a discrepancy and different in charges across those two networks today, so we're embarking on a piece of work to look at that holistic charging space to say what is the right way to charge for access to networks across GB.
Yeah. Saying then that the Scottish Government's statement that there is thermal generation needed to maintain the resilience of the system, is that not correct then? You think you can maintain the resilience through your interconnector?
Yes, the work that we've just completed and reporting to CIAB in a few weeks' time demonstrates that with the right network investment that we've got time to do over the next 10 years or so, that yes, we can maintain the 5.5 gigawatts of demand security that's required in Scotland.
Gil Patterson.
Yeah, thanks very much. My question is related to the Scottish Government getting involved in forming a company to deliver some of the services. So I'm wondering if there's any legal impediment or regulatory requirement that would cause them maybe to fail in their endeavours. And at the same time, is there any risks and liabilities for the Scottish Government if they did become involved in forming a company in the for the energy market?
I'm happy to start with that one. So we'll be speaking to the Scottish Government about what exactly the government's energy company would do. There are already a range of companies, so local authorities, I think, provide, in some areas, have formed their own energy companies. And we are very happy, well, we work with them already. We work with the Scottish Government on their plans. We will, just taking a step back, we are seeing, as well as innovation in technology, we're also seeing a lot of innovation in business models as the energy system changes. And one of the areas is the desire for local energy companies or different kinds of energy companies. And we're really keen to work with parties who are interested in this, because we don't sit with all the best ideas ourselves. We are rather narrow-thinking regulators. But we really do want to work effectively with innovators to make sure that the companies come forward, that they can bring new things for consumers, be that environmental benefits, be that lower cost benefits, but at the same time that consumers are protected and they know what they're buying into when they get a supply from a particular company. So we haven't gone into a lot of detail with the Scottish Government yet. We have, you know, some similar models for, I think, the kind of thing that they're proposing, but we're very keen to work with them on this. Just there's a couple of initiatives we've started fairly recently. So one is the innovation link, where you go on our website and you can get help if you're thinking of setting up a new type of business, to understand what the regulatory implications may be. Because we know, you know, the energy market isn't that simple, and we don't want all the rules, which in some sense are there for a good place, to be a real barrier for entry for new business models. We've also got what we call a regulatory sandbox, which actually allows some new business models to trial things on a small scale to see how it works for them. So, you know, welcome this initiative, and we'll work with the Scottish Government to you know, understand exactly what they want to do with the company and make sure if it's a good thing for consumers that there aren't, you know, barriers in place for doing the right thing.
Okay, thanks so much for that. Thank you.
We'll move on then to, I think Andy Whiteman had another question.
Yes, just thank you, Convener. Following up from that, I mean, there's a lot of interest in developing local energy networks. In fact, some commentators suggest that that is a key part of the way forward. And we've heard from you, Kirsty, on the regulatory side of it and a willingness to consider these and to help people develop their business models. But in terms of the actual grid, are we in a position where, because we've built up a model of a GB grid, that developing local systems might be problematic? We need to new, or you're shaking your head.
So there's many examples already of local solutions either in place or in development. So there's many regional constraints in our network that we could manage it through traditional ways by contracting with the transmission-based generation. But that wouldn't be the efficient thing to do. So working with the relevant local distribution network operator, we can install some smart black boxes on the network, I guess, that's monitoring the system conditions and taking the right actions based against a set of commercial rules that involves all of the local generation plus the more sort of the larger sort of transmission-based generation. And also you get pockets of some great work that the distribution company is doing. So the Nines project, which is on, is it Shetland or Orkney? I can't remember which, but they've gone for a full integrated diesel generator, battery storage, consumer behavior, consumer device in the home, combined with the renewable energy, and it's a fully integrated network. And because of an island-based community, it's quite, I guess, quite straightforward to isolate that and get a real good working example of how a smart, I guess, integrated energy system can work. We're seeing pockets within UKPNs down in the south, so around some of the London projects. We're seeing great innovation that's really bringing together energy production with energy consumption and smart devices that work in conjunction with the network as well. So we'll just see more and more of this, and just ourselves, National Grid and UK Power Networks, we've just won a one of these network innovation funds. We just won a project to look at that whole system transmission distribution interface to ensure that we are operating the network on a whole system basis, not just thinking about transmission and then distribution do their own thing, really bringing these two things together, which is essential as we move to a decentralised energy network, of which Scotland, you've been leading the way on that. The distributed generation you have in Scotland has always been head and shoulders above what's elsewhere in England and Wales. The big push for solar that we had in the last 12 months, the very south now has more embedded distributed generation than it does in Scotland. But the issues are the same. We've worked very closely with Scottish Power Distribution and SSE Distribution up in Scotland to find these innovative solutions. And as technology progresses and as we get confidence that these black boxes do the right thing and do it and work in the right way, then we're on the verge and the cusp, I think, of really seeing a big scale rollout of these types of network innovations. Because it's a lot cheaper to install a black box for the few days where the wind is really, really high and the demand is really, really low, that it takes the right action rather than having to build new transmission just that they would get used for a few hours or a few days a year. So we'll see. It's an efficient way to maximise the capacity on the network.
So the short answer, therefore, is you don't see, from a regulatory point of view or from an infrastructure point of view, any significant barriers to developing a decentralised energy supply and consumption system.
So I think just from the regulatory perspective, it's something we welcome. It's, you know, we agree that the dividing line between the bigger networks and the smaller networks is becoming merged. There are more ways of making better use of energy. There are lots of opportunities at a local level. We are also looking at the implications of that for funding the long-term costs of the infrastructure. So the network infrastructure was built years ago in most cases. The payback period is usually about 40 years. We don't want to stifle any local developments, but we want to make sure the costs of running the networks and the fixed costs of the networks are shared in a fair way amongst consumers generally. So what we wouldn't, I think, given that we've got a primary duty to protect consumers, what we wouldn't want to see is an increasingly small number of consumers who are dependent on the main infrastructure funding it all while more consumers go off-grid and getting effectively a free ride despite the fact the infrastructure is there as a backup. So it has to be a fair sharing of the costs, and that's an issue that we're actively looking at. So we welcome local energy initiatives, we welcome more and more happening locally, but we need to make sure that consumers as a whole are treated fairly and the costs are apportioned in the right way.
Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. I'd like to thank all of our witnesses. If there are any other further points you'd like to submit in writing to the committee, we'd be glad to receive these. And I'll now close this session and we'll move into private session, allowing the public gallery an opportunity to clear. Thank you very much.